I'm going to ask Professor Martin Zaal from Technical University of Darmstadt to give the talk, and talk is going to be the stochastic primitive equation with transport noise and turbulent pressure. So please go ahead.
Thank you for the introduction and thanks to the organizers, particularly for giving me a talk after 10 o'clock and not at 6:30 in the morning here. So I will talk today about stochastic primitive equations with transport noise and turbulent pressure, which is a joint work with Antonio Agresti, who's now at IST in Austria, Matthias Hieber from Darmstadt, and Amr Hussein, now in Kaiserslautern, also in Darmstadt formerly. And when Matthias is appearing on the slide, you can guess it will be about a maximal regularity approach. So before I start our maximal regularity approach, I will give some motivation why considering equations with transport noise, especially why considering some Navier-Stokes type system with transport noise. Then it will be about the stochastic primitive equations, and then I'll talk about different kind of noises. So mostly one likes to take Itô noise because it's the one which is taking the most time in mathematics. The other one, which is important, is Bertonovich from a pi point of view. So let's start with the motivation. I give the motivation for Navier-Stokes and turbulent flows because for the primitive equations, there is up to now no real finished stochastic modeling. There are a few attempts, but the full stochastic modeling is an open problem in primitive equations. So for Navier-Stokes, it's rather old to model turbulent flows by stochastics. There are two different ideas leading to the same kind of noise in the end. The first idea is the stochastic Lagrangian approach, which was proposed already by Reynolds some time ago. The idea is that the velocity field has some slowly oscillating part, which is deterministic, and the very fast oscillating part, which you model in a random way, because it's so fast oscillating, you cannot measure it in a good way, and so on. So the idea is really to say, this is something random, I have no chance to capture it by deterministic tools or by measurements. And so the U here is a deterministic velocity field, and then it has a stochastic contribution. Beta is a Brownian motion, so here we have a derivative of a Brownian motion, which is pretty rough, and phi is some modulation function. And if you use this approach, do the standard modeling for phi at least a little bit smooth, so it's in some Hölder space, see alpha for alpha greater than zero, then going with this ansatz into Newton's law gives you a Navier-Stokes system, you use standard Navier-Stokes nonlinearity, and additionally a contribution. So the series here is because one beta is not enough, then you would have just noise in one direction. If you want to capture all directions, you need a full basis. So phi n's, you can think of a base of two, for example. So phi n's additionally to being C alpha. And then you have here something which looks similar. So it's also a transport term, but now you have here the phi n which transports the velocity field. And the time dependence of the stochastic term is fully captured in the beta. So here, this is a stochastic transport in the end, because it's transported by this modulation function and with respect to the beta ends to the stochastic terms. This is already written in this stochastic version of PDEs, because most of you will know beta is not really differentiable. You have to read these equations always. Then this equation is Navier-Stokes equation for turbulent flows. And the idea is really that turbulence is a very small scale phenomena, which then has some effect on the large scales. And so when you go into this approach with exactly this idea, oh, sorry, I forgot to say, C alpha then was relaxed later on by Kreitner to assuming that you are in some H eta psi space, where psi is such that by Sobolev embedding, this embeds into C alpha. So this is a more general theory, better suited for mostly PDE analysis, because the H-eta-xi spaces fit quite good to the Navier-Stokes equation from the regular point of view to investigate it in an LP setting. That's the idea. Consider this one. That the xi has to be at least 2 has really a meaning. So stochastic equations, most stochastic terms are built over some Hilbert space. Because that's where you start. You start building stochastic terms over Hilbert spaces, and then you can extend them, try to extend them to LP settings. But you want to be the Hilbert space in your LP, so you have to take P at least equal to 2. Less than 2, there's no good stochastic theory, as far as I know. So now, the idea of small scale, that stochastic is a small scale phenomena. That's the second approach. Now you say, okay, we can divide our Navier-Stokes solution, our velocity field, into some large and a small scale. You can also think of it in time scales, so to have some fast and some slow variable, for example. Then obviously you can split it up. And the splitting is most, the coupling is then due to the nonlinearity. So you have one equation for the large scale, which is coupled to the small scale by the nonlinearity and the other way around. And now the idea is the sum source Navier-Stokes, but it would be easier if we know US already. So if we don't have this coupled system, but if we say just US is something known. And that's this, a stochastic approach to just really say by physical arguments that the small scales are completely stochastic term, which is known for some reason. For example, by measurements again and so on. So in a turbulent regime, it's a really good physical approximation. Also numerics show it that it's a good idea to model it in this way, that you just say US is given the small scales. And if you plug this in, again here US is a full series over some phi n times Brownian motion, so all beta n are again Brownian motions, which means that you need the series again to have not just one direction in the L2, but to have the full L2. So if you plug this in, you get the same equation as before. So from two different points of view, one time to say that the velocity field is something deterministic plus something stochastic, or from saying that the stochastics are completely coming from the small scales, you end up with the same stochastic Navier-Stokes system. And both times, it's a transport type of noise. And that's why transport type of noise is considered to be a very good model for turbulence. I say it's considered to be a good model because it's not proven, actually. So numerics indicated there are a lot of results which show that it's close to somehow the real world and to being really a description of turbulences, but there's no rigorous proof of some convergence that this, if you take the stochastic terms and try to scale them in a right way, that converges to the full solution of Navier-Stokes or something that people try, but it's not resolved yet, this issue. And the idea of replacing difficult nonlinear terms, because here's this coupling of US to UL, that's one of the difficult parts in Navier-Stokes. If you think again about time scales, you have the slow variables, fast variables, and coupling between them is what makes things difficult. So this idea to replace deterministic terms by stochastic ones, but in a way that it still gives something which is close to the real solution, is also called stochastic model reduction, and used a lot in numerics and really for the from the applied people. So not just for the numerics, if you think about we do something like for Navier-Stokes, but also when they try to calculate real world things like weather or like climate models. Then this model reduction helps because here this thing, you know, it's a linear term, which makes the full equation much easier than considering this model here. So that's the idea why transport noise is a good model for small scales. And the main idea is that these stochastic terms come from the small scales. For example, if you think about a river, in the interior, in the large scale, you will have really no, not too much turbulences, but on the boundaries, you get somehow small turbulences, which then emanate which then go into the river, which is middle. And that's the idea of this equation, that the stochastics transport somehow problems into the domain where it should be nice. So you can also see it as some modeling of turbulences on really on a spatial spot scale, not just if you think here about time scales, it's also in a spatial sense, you can see it as a good model. So now, what is the other advantage why transport noises seem to be fitting good to Navier-Stokes is that it works well with the scaling for Navier-Stokes. So I motivated it now from a modeling point of view, where you say, if we model it in a special way, we just get really this transport term. The other way around is a good stochastic term to be added, which preserves certain properties of Navier-Stokes, is really transport noise. So if you take a solution to the Navier-Stokes equation, you can scale it. And with this scaling, this equation is invariant. It's not too difficult to see. If you now take a transport noise and you scale the betas here by lambda to the minus 1/2, so it's more or less the same scaling. If you look here, the scaling is very similar. And you plug this in. Here again, as I said, stochastic equations have to be interpreted as integrated in time. So you calculate these time integrals and you see that exactly the same happens. Both times you get a lambda to the 1/2. But there's one difference here. The u lambda is scaled, not the phi. So the phi in the stochastic term is not scaled, just the beta is scaled in the stochastic term and the u is scaled, which means that in the end, this stochastic effect has the same scaling, so it preserves the scaling if you keep the phi invariant. So if the phi is not scaled at the same time. If you see it here, you have two functions which are scaled. So in the end, there is another power of lambda coming out here if you would scale both. That's has some deep meaning in the stochastic setting, because also if you think about the smoothing by stochastic terms, it's weaker than the one by deterministic terms. So if you have a stochastic equation and the right-hand side, so you know this phi with some regularity, this term is not as smooth as a deterministic counterpart would be if you solve the equation with this right-hand side. And that's really because the scaling is just working here with beta. So there are a lot of reasons to say that stochastic models, or that transport noise is a very good model to capture turbulences, instead of really trying to solve deterministically really the very small scales. Just say you add a transport noise and you say the velocity field is then just a large scale field. So, and this modeling really preserves the natural scaling of the Navier-Stokes equation, and it also preserves the scaling of primitive equations, for example. So now let's come to the primitive equations. First of all, the primitive equations are derived from Navier-Stokes by a hydrostatic approximation. And that's why we assumed in our paper, I will come later to it, that we can take a similar kind of noise as for Navier-Stokes, which is then acting more or less mostly on the horizontal directions. So if you consider a domain where the vertical scale is rather small compared to the horizontal one, if you think about the ocean, okay, it's deep. If you go to the very deep point at the ocean, you have 10, 11 kilometers, but the horizontal scale is much, much bigger still. And also in the atmosphere is, the vertical scale is not small, but compared to the horizontal scale, it's getting small. So a good model is that you say, we have a domain, here the torus is just for simplicity, where we have a horizontal scale, which is rather big compared to a vertical scale. And then we want to let the vertical scale really go to zero. So that's the idea. Consider Navier-Stokes in this domain with a small vertical scale, direction. And then you take an anisotropic Navier-Stokes, because also the viscosity depends on how large the scale is in that direction. So here you have epsilon squared. And here, as I said, the scaling behavior of the stochastic term is mostly a square root of the one of the deterministic terms. So here we have an epsilon. And then you want to let epsilon go to zero and see if there is a good limiting model for the case of vanishing of a vanishing vertical scale. And that's the primitive equations. So obviously this is it's not a good idea to consider, well, to try for this setting to let epsilon go to zero. A good idea is to first transform it where the domain doesn't depend on epsilon. Because if you try to let this go to zero, you won't end up with a very good model because of the really vanishing part of the domain. So you decompose the velocity field into some velocity in the vertical direction and a horizontal one, which is always called W in all models of primitive equations. And then you rescale everything on the domain towards times minus 1, 0 or minus h for the haze of the domains and the end. And you scale in the third variable everything because so the W here is the only term, it's only in the vertical direction. You also scale the function itself and not just the variable. The reason is the incompressibility condition. It has to be preserved when you take the limit. And if you want to preserve the incompressibility with some epsilon, then you have to scale the W also. So plugging it all in, calculating a little bit, one sees that you end up with this equation. Here we have an epsilon squared. Here in front of the Laplacian, we have an epsilon squared. And the equation for V doesn't change at all. So the horizontal directions, they still satisfy some Navier-Stokes type system. The vertical direction, there you have the epsilons. And if you now let epsilon go to zero, and you have good estimates for W in the Navier-Stokes system, then a lot of terms here cancel. And what's left is just the pressure and the third equation for Navier-Stokes. And this means that the pressure is just independent of that. This is a very simplified situation. Normally, one should also assume a different temperature. I'm talking about the climate weather model and water for the ocean. The temperature has a huge influence. Then the third, then P depends on the temperature in the vertical direction, but still in a way that you can transform it so that you can transform it to a system where you have this. So this is called the hypothetic approximation. And what's left is an unknown pressure, which is just a surface pressure, just depending on the horizontal variables. So this is really pressure just acting on a surface, and that's it. And as I said, in the full models with temperature and so on, you can transform the pressure to have, again, just a surface pressure. This has been by now done rigorously. For example, by Fukava, Giga, Hiva, Hussein, Kashibabara, and Gona, just 6 people were needed to prove it, that really the Navier-Stokes system converges to the primitive equations. So this is not just formally, and like physicists like to do it, just say, when we now plug in epsilon equal to zero, or cancels and so on, it's proven mathematically. And the big advantage of the primitive system now is the pressure is two-dimensional. And with a two-dimensional pressure, you can solve Navier-Stokes globally. So for 2D Navier-Stokes is known and also primitive, this set of equations is globally well posed, mainly because the pressure is two-dimensional. So what the major difficulty of Navier-Stokes somehow canceled, but what's getting more difficult is here the nonlinearity, because the W has no evolution equation anymore. W is not smoothed by the system. And so W is only given by the divergence free condition, which means that it loses a derivative compared to the V. So this, the nonlinearity is stronger, the pressure is better. That's somehow the idea of primitive equations. So here, a short slide to have an overview. So for Navier-Stokes, we have an evolution equation for W. For the primitive equations, this evolution equation becomes a constraint for the pressure because it says that it's independent of that. In Navier-Stokes, the divergence speed condition is a constraint for the velocity. In the primitive equation, the divergence speed condition somehow gives you the evolution for the W because it's completely determined by the equation. Now, we have Stokes' directions are equivalent, primitive equations obviously not. And here comes the point which makes it really much better. Full pressure is replaced by a surface pressure. And also for the Navier-Stokes system, you have divergence free. For primitive equations, the mean value in the vertical direction is the divergence free. And you can completely replace the vertical velocity in the equations. So in speaking with physical language, it means that W, which was a prognostic variable before, is now a diagnostic one, which means that you don't calculate by an evolution equation just given by the other properties from the system. And so now let's go to the stochastic primitive equations. The idea is to say we have the standard deterministic primitive equation, and we add a stochastic transport term. So at this point, we don't have a full modeling for it. I motivated it by showing that this is a good model for turbulence, and also primitive equations have turbulences. But it's not that there's a rigorous stochastic modeling or something like that. This is really just saying to take into account certain effects, we add a stochastic term. And the unknown is obviously the B, which we want to calculate. So now the boundary conditions one takes. For W, they are fixed. They are really fixed by the modeling. You have Dirichlet boundary conditions for W in the vertical direction. This is pretty important because if you have them, this condition here allows you to really calculate W from the divergence free condition. So you have this boundary condition, which means that W is just the integral over the horizontal divergence of the horizontal directions. And the second boundary condition here, that also on the top of the domain, you have W equal to zero, means exactly these horizontal divergence free conditions I just mentioned. So this equation, together with the boundary conditions, can completely be replaced by saying we know W, and we have horizontal divergence free. And that's somehow the model for the primitive equations. So the divergence free condition again determines the pressure. This is the divergence free condition just for the horizontal variables, but also the pressure is just depending on the horizontal variables, so one can believe it. But there's also a good projection. So this works a little bit as for Navier-Stokes. You can construct some hydrostatic Helmholtz projection, which replaces the standard Helmholtz projection in the primitive setting. The idea is to construct it as for the standard Helmholtz projection. So you solve Laplacian equal to divergence. The difference here is we just have that the mean value is divergence free. So vertical mean value is divergence free. So here we have, again, additional is the integral, and we need also this condition to determine it uniquely. If not, you again can shift it by constants. And now the hypostatic Helmholtz projection is given as F minus this part here, minus the solution here, which you can rewrite. It's the same as F minus the 2D Helmholtz projection applied to the mean value. That's what the hypostatic Helmholtz projection do. So if you apply the hypostatic Helmholtz projection to something, then it's really, you subtract the horizontal gradient of the Helmholtz projection. This is again an orthogonal projection on L2, and it's also bound on H1. So nearly all the properties of the Helmholtz projection are also true for the hypostatic one. In the torus, you can even calculate it explicitly by Fourier series, so that's not a problem. And it projects on the horizontally divergence free vector fields, where the mean value is horizontally divergence free. And the orthogonality property is also true. So if you apply it to a horizontal gradient, then it's equal to zero. So this is really good to handle the surface pressure. Really, it's a complete replacement for the Helmholtz projection. So when applying it to our primitive equation, then we are looking for a solution of the system here. So EV, here we have the standard primitive equation. Now we replace the W by a W of V term. So we say this is just a short writing for this integral. And then we can choose boundary conditions also for V. And that's the tricky part. So boundary conditions for V, the easiest one is the one I've written down here, if you take Neumann in the vertical direction, because you can then use some symmetry arguments, and that means mainly it's periodic. So this setting can be transformed to a periodic setting. So no boundary situation is easy. The most realistic boundary conditions would be to take Neumann on top and Dirichlet on the bottom of the domain, but that's far more involved. There are just not too many results in that direction. And to study the stochastic system, we decided to take the easy boundary conditions. On the lateral boundaries, this is for laziness to take the torus. At this point, our result in the paper is then really for Dirichlet boundary conditions in the lateral directions, which are more physical. So physically, if you think again, you want to model the atmosphere, you know what's on the boundary of the domain where you can. So now comes our result on a simplified version for the primitive equations. So if we have an H1 initial value, which is horizontally divergence free, or the mean value in the vertical direction is horizontally divergence free, then under some assumptions, which means it has to have a little bit smoother the phi ends, not too much indeed, then there is a unique local maximal solution with the regularities you can expect to the system. The full result, if you look in the paper, we have much more terms in the for the noise, so we can also add lower order terms, we have forcing additionally and so on. But this captures the main features and the main difficulty. That's really the transport part. And if now the prefactors here, so the phi is a vector field, and if the first two components are independent of x3, which means that when I take here mean value, then the first two components don't see the integrand, it goes completely to the V here, then the solution is even global, already for just H1 data. It's really the analog result, which is known in the deterministic setting. And then suitable assumption on phi n mostly means also smallest assumptions. But what's the main point, what we could do, and what was not known before, is that our smallest assumption on the phi n is just needed to make sure that we have still a parabolic system. So we don't need a smallest assumption to handle this one as some nonlinear perturbation of the nice equation. We really see this part together with the noise here as one linear system. And then we only need a natural assumption that says we have yield smoothing. So for people who are not experienced with stochastic equations, this linear part is as strong as a Laplacian. So this first derivative in the stochastic term is as strong as a Laplacian. So if the phi ends are getting too big and have a bad sign, then this can destroy really smoothing effects. So there is some assumption on smallness for phi n, but it's not really a smallness assumption in the sense that you do nonlinear theory. It's really a smallness assumption that says a linear system needs to be a smoothing system, and that's all. And the point why we could prove this is that we had another point of view. By seeing this not as a right-hand side, which then is handled by some equation or a fixed point argument at the end, we see it as part of the linear system and just the nonlinear terms of the right-hand side for us. And then we need much less smallest assumptions than previous works on it. So the deterministic case was done by Chow and Titi and also by Kudelkov nearly at the same time, with different methods, also for H1. And the stochastic case, the most recent result is by Brezhnev and Slavik. There are two big papers on the existence of solutions. One is by Debusch, Blathos, Thema, and I'm missing one, Extinciano also. The other one by Brezhnev and Slavik. They both have a very strong smallness assumption on the phi, much stronger than we have. And they don't have such a general noise. in the first result by Yehosh and so on, they even don't have transport noise because of the approach. Reshniak and Slavik have transport noise, but not acting on the full velocity field. They can just allow for transport noise, where we have here already a mean value of V in the vertical direction. So our result is more general in the noises we can assume, and we don't have any smallest condition which is not natural for having a smoothing. And the point is, I haven't talked about up to now, the title of the talk was with transport noise and turbulent pressure, and I haven't said anything about turbulent pressure up to now. So here it looks like we just have a pressure in this part, or we had just a pressure in this part. But if we now model it in such a way that also the stochastic part contains a pressure term here, which then balances divergence coming from this term here, then we can do better than the previous works. So some comments. The regularity of phi n in the end is h1 c plus delta. It's for reasons if you go through the proof. So I don't want to present here a lot of estimates on this. That's really what you get in the end. And this Kaichnan theory is included. So Kaichnan says, this is the correct noise you have to assume if you take the psi equal to 2 in what I've written in at the beginning. Then this, you need some eta such that you're in the space, and that space is contained in our space. So we can do Kaichnan's noise, which is an important point. And we have a turbulent pressure. So the turbulent pressure is a random component of a pressure. And if you calculate this projection, then it's phi n minus gradient of some function. I showed you the projection, so we know this function, we can calculate it. And additionally, we can do physical relevant noise. I will comment in the end about it. That's Stratonovich noise. So if I go back shortly, here, this noise is meant as Itô noise. As always, when there's no special symbol between the functions here and the noise term. Later on, I will show that also Stratonovich noise is possible. That's another kind of noise which leads to a variable viscosity. So we first had to prove everything for the Laplacian, and then we had to prove it for Laplacian plus some variable viscosity. The paper is 60 pages long due to that. It's a little bit lengthy to read. So how have we proven it? The full proof splits into three parts. First of all, we take a linear system, then with some forcing here, and additionally a stochastic forcing to prove local existence and piecewise regularity. The idea is more or less the standard one, which you know for nearly all approaches by maximal regularity. You take this linear system, prove some maximal regularity property, and then you can do some iteration or some fixed point argument. And so last year, Agresti and Beral, they proved that this approach works also well for nonlinear parabolic stochastic evolution equations. So stochastic maximal regularity was known before, but this one is a far more evolved version of the stochastic maximal regularity. It also contains something on critical space and so on. But the main point is you can now take linear stochastic terms into the linear system. We have here full stochastic maximal regularity approach. And not just this deterministic system, which is maximal which has maximal regularity, applied to a stochastic equation, but the stochastic terms are really part of this maximal regularity approach, and also operator you consider. And the difficulty for this transport term is really that it's not of lower order compared to the Laplacian. It's really the same order. So you have to make sure that this is still a parabolic system. You need some the phi n really needs some conditions to have probabilicity. So the semigroup approach, if you just use the semigroup approach, I mean, something like you have here a nice smooth semigroup and here something of the same strange that's not directly applicable. You need to handle it another way. That's either by very strong smallest conditions or our approach, other ways, I don't know at the moment. And the estimate you need to handle it is called stochastic maximal LP regularity. which looks the same as the deterministic one with stochastic terms. So to prove now the existence of maximal solutions, you need a blow-up criterion. And that works really as for the deterministic system again. So you have, as long as the norms, the natural norms here, that's the norm of the initial data, stays bounded, which means that the probability that, that it doesn't stay bounded is zero. So just a zero set where there could be a blow up, then you can continue the solution. And then you glue together local solutions and get a global one. So it's not a direct global approach, it's really an approach we can solve it up to every time key in the LP setting. And that's how you get the global existence. So if you have an energy estimate here, which says that the expected values are bounded, then also this probability that this one here is infinity has to be zero because they are bounded by some term, and you can deduce the global existence. So that's pretty similar to the deterministic situation. The difference is that you need to have estimates in the expected value here, because you cannot prove any good pairwise estimates, essentially. Well, mainly because of stochastic term. And so you can solve it up to some tau. Tau here is not a time, it's a stopping time, which is a little bit more complicated. I don't want to comment on that too long. So, having done all this by energy estimates, we can somehow prove the global existence. I don't want to show you how to deduce energy estimates. It's rather similar to the deterministic one by replacing multiplication of the equation with a function with Stieger formula. A little bit more interesting is the stochastic maximal L2 regularity. That's this point. Because there you can explain it a little bit without getting too technical. So, if you have for each f, which is in L2 with values in some L2 space here, that's here the p is again the projection applied to L2, so it's something like solenoidal field just with respect to the Helmholtz projection. And the g's are L2 with values h1, they can be more regular. Then a unique solution to v should satisfy the estimate that in the space where you expect the solution to be, in this parabolic regularity space, there you can estimate by the data. That's stochastic maximum regularity. Here's no time regularity written because solutions to stochastic equations have no time derivative in the classical sense. That's just because the beta is too rough. So the equation itself, this one here, is already in a negative space. So you cannot expect the time derivative to really exist. You just have an estimate for the function itself. And so if you can prove that for all data, this holds, then you have stochastic maximum regularity. And then you can proceed really similar as for the maximum regularity approach from the deterministic setting. So how to prove that you have stochastic maximum regularity? It's rather difficult. It's like you try to prove maximum regularity by really calculating solutions in the estimates by hand. So we needed a trick. And the trick is the method of continuity. If you have a nice maximal regular operator here already, then you add the stochastic term with the lambda in front, and you can prove an a priori estimate independent of lambda without showing the existence here. So just saying, if we have a solution of this, then we need an estimate. Then we can already conclude that we have maximal stochastic regularity. So how to prove such an, there's an ohm missing, this should be an Itos formula. So we apply Itos formula to this term, integrate by parts on the left-hand side. And then we get, for the stochastic term, an estimate mainly against second derivatives here. And that's really why it is as strong as the Laplacian. So here you see, when I want to estimate, here's some a natural norm, which is the L2 norm of the right-hand side, integrated in time and then taking the expected value. So integrate one times in the probability space, the underlying one. Then you get an estimate against second derivatives. So it's really as strong as the Laplacian. And here you see what we mean by we need a condition to have parabolicity. This one has to be absorbed by the Laplacian. So that's really the parabolicity assumption that you can estimate this one against some new times, really second derivatives. And parabolicity means now really that this sum here is less than mu times xi squared for some new in zero quantity. And here, this we can estimate then by mu prime times the full Laplacian, and here we have some lower order term, and then the mu prime has to be in mu and 2, because 2 is the one we can absorb here. And cutlet formula really means that you can here use also in the stochastic setting an estimate of the mixed derivatives against the Laplacian. So the mixed derivative can be estimated by the Laplacian plus some lower order terms. And so by also taking into account all other terms, doing a lot of estimates and calculating long time, we end up to prove this estimate here. As you see, I'm just talking about L2, because all what we did in this paper is the L2 setting. The point is really that doing something like this in the LP setting is far more involved. In the L2 setting, we have some more tricks, we have a scalar product and so on. So here we could prove it. In the LP setting, we are working on it. It's very lengthy, it should hold, but we haven't finished that part. And so now, if we now have additionally this independence, then we can show the global existence. That's just written here once. Again, we have an energy estimate if those two functions here are independent of x3. The key observation how to prove this is, as always, for primitive equations. If you consider the primitive equations and you split them up, you can split them up into equations for the vertical average and the remainder. The vertical average has satisfies the 2D Navier-Stokes, and the remainder is 3D heat equation. And the main point now is the pressure just appears in the equation for the V bar, for the horizontal average, because it's independent of Z. That means we have here a very nice Navier-Stokes equation where estimates are known, where you can do a lot, a 3D heat equation which is coupled in a way that you can handle it. We had an L4 estimate for this heat equation using the cancellation property. And the independence of P on X3 means that you can always also get estimates for the vertical derivative of V, which is just the same as the vertical derivative of V tilde. And so you get to a result in the end. The point is to do this estimate, you need an H1 estimated uniform for V bar, and an H1 estimate for the 2D Navier-Stokes equation is available due to the two-dimensional of the pressure. That's somehow the idea. But as I said, the proofs here are very lengthy and I don't want to explain them. So these terms are really available. Again, then you can glue all together and get a nice result. So now, in the end, let me shortly comment on a different kind of noise. The point is, you can define the stochastic integral in different ways. So the stochastic, if you want to define this integral here, the stochastic integral with respect to some Brownian motion, it's not a Riemann-Stieltjes integral because Brownian motion is not smooth enough. But by all the properties Brownian motion has, such a Riemann sum here converges. And that's what you call the Itô integral. If you have here a Riemann sum, this is a Si minus one here, that's written for a partition of the interval. You have here a Riemann sum where you take at the lower boundary of the partition always the value of g, then you end up with Itô integral. The advantage is this integral definition gives you an Itô isometry. But you are free to choose here. You can also take g of a mean value. You go to the right end, to the left end of the partition, divided by 2, that's the mean value. That's Stratonovich. You could also go to the right end completely, so take your g of Si. It gives a different kind of stochastic integral with different properties, but they are all a definition of a stochastic integral. Now, this one has a nice Itô isometry, the Sviatonovich integral, if you take the mean value here, the calculus gets similar to the deterministic one. If you, the E2 formula, if you apply E2 formula to something, you get a correction term always. If you apply some here, it's already the corrected version somehow. So all these integrals here are a good definition if you take your different values, and they can be transformed into each other. And that's also the main trick we did to handle Sviatonovich. So Sviatonovich, from the applied point of view, the physicists and the modeling people, they like Sviatonovich much more because it's closer to the realistic situation in some sense. I can't explain why it's in this talk, but this one is to seen as the nice integral for application. This one is the one where you have mathematically the best property and where you have the most formulas. The good news now is the two integrals differ by a correction term. You can calculate always. So here, this is with a circ here, then it's Sviatonovich noise. If you calculate this one, you can write it as E2 noise plus some correction term. So now I've planned to do some derivation of the correction term here and skip a little bit at the beginning of the talk. But then I figured out, or I remember, that Panko gave at Waseda University this May lecture series where you can look it up. Here he really did the calculation of this correction term. So you can rewrite this full correction, the correction term here by some linear operator plus some lower order terms. And the linear operator gives you in a dissipation by noise, which is, first of all, it looks like if we assume now another kind of noise, we get a dissipation additionally. But here we have a variable dissipation, and this one is as strong as a dissipation by noise. So it's not really that you get by the stochastic integral a dissipative term, because the whole thing here has to be corrected again, and then it just, it looks like you get a dissipation for free, but it's not really a dissipation. But this is really the correction term you get in the end. Plus here's some lower order terms, so they are. And so to handle Sviatonovich, you just have to rewrite all the proofs you did for E2, and now instead of a Laplace from the quadratic equations, write something which depends on the spatial variable or operator. But an operator which depends in a good way on the spatial variable, so it's uniformly, it has uniformly maximal regularity and so on. That sounds now a little bit easy. It's lengthy to do all that, but it's straight, rather straightforward, I would call it. So Sviatonovich noise, if you can solve E2 equation with variable dissipation and with a lot of additional coefficients, then you can interpret Sviatonovich as a special case of it by this transformation. So now in the end, some open problems. First of all, is this assumption really necessary for global existence that they are independent of extreme? We know a way to loosen it a little bit, but we haven't seen any application for them, the assumption we have. It would mean that we can additionally take into account some noise just acting on this remainder term with the prefactor, which is just depending on the vertical variable and not on the horizontal one. So that's somehow artificial. It's an artificial condition. We don't know if we can really relax it in a realistic way. The point is, this one we needed to have the nice splitting properties also for the stochastic term. We had that all the global existence results are based really on having the splitting for the primitive equations. And so we needed to impose something on the noise that the noise also works fine with the splitting we have into this V bar and V tilde. So I'm not sure if we can really relax this in a good way, which is not just artificially adding some terms which exactly did. There are some good ideas, I would like to hear them. The other one is the primitive equation is physical boundaries conditions. So on the lower boundary, would like to have Dirichlet, which is much more complicated. Really, this independence of these three is that you have a homogeneous Neumann makes it easier, because if you go again to the splitting, when you calculate V bar, it means you integrate the equation from minus one to zero. if you have Neumann and you integrate the vertical Laplacian, I'm nearly finished, so I have the time. I see this one. If you integrate the vertical Laplacian from minus one to zero, you get first derivatives on the boundary. With Neumann, they just cancel. With Dirichlet, this gives you a term from the Laplacian. You have d, then in the equation for V bar, d3V of minus one appears, which has to be handled. So there's a boundary term then in the equation itself, which is difficult. Then influence of the temperature. So if we have here additional temperature, and at the same time our turbulent pressure does not depend on it, that's difficult. We need it here to make some assumptions that everything fits nicely. We don't know if it's, from the modeling point of view, a good assumption. So here, this one we would like to have also, but it's more difficult than we expected at the moment. We are working on this. So I think this is solvable. LPIQ theory, as I said, that's a lot of technique, and you need a good way to prove the maximum regularity, the stochastic maximum regularity. And then regularization by transport noise. Is the solution even getting better because of the noise? We showed the noise help still preserves that we have global solutions under some conditions. But there are examples where a transport noise gives you a better properties of solutions, where it really show, where you really see that some kind of noise helps you in the theory. And finally, a rigorous justification of our model. Therefore, we need, first of all, this influence of the temperature, and then we need to see if the stochastic Navier-Stokes equation converge to our stochastic primitive equation in the right spaces. So these two we are working at the moment, or the other LZ3, this one influence and here. This we perhaps have an idea, the other ones are really open problems. So that's it, and thank you for the attention.
Okay, thank you very much for your nice talk. And now we shall start with discussions. Any questions from the people? Right. So may I ask you a
question?
Professor Rakhi will have a question.
Oh, yes. Yes, I do, if I may. Martin, you know that there are hyperbolized, relaxed versions of Navier-Stokes, but in general, if one wishes to use the tool of maximal regularity, one has little chance in hyperbolic problems. But you pointed out that you do not use the full equivalent of maximal regularity, but a little less, not involving the estimate on the time derivative, right? You pointed out that. So now my simple question is, do you see a chance now with this somehow reduced idea of maximal regularity to extend this to some hyperbolic problems?
For a feeling, I would say no.
Mm-hmm.
Because
it's still too much. Mm-hmm.
I was a little bit imprecise here at this point. So we have this estimate. I don't know exactly on which slide it was. It's from time ago. You have a little bit more than just the estimate I've written down.
Mm-hmm.
You also have here for the I'm too far. So there we have it. You also have here an estimate.
Yep.
With V here continuous in time with values in this parabolic space where the initial data lies standard.
Oh, I see.
Mm-hmm. So okay, there's a second contribution to this estimate.
Mm-hmm.
For parabolic problems, this estimate is enough to get the other one also. Yep. But for hyperbolic, you would need then an optimal estimate also with respect to the initial value. So with continuous.
Okay.
And I think that's the point where it's getting at least very difficult.
I understand. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
So any other question? Uh, So I may ask you a question. You know, this is the deterministic case which you refer due to Kao and Titi, and somehow their result is good because they have a global will poseness. That means that existence and uniqueness and global. And can you get it for this stochastic nonlinear model?
It's also global under the assumption that the phi n's, so the solution is really global mm-hmm. if these here are independent of xv. So if we have the splitting also for the equation with noise, then we can, it's in the spirit of Chao and Titi with similar estimates, but there's a little bit later, there was a work by Kashi Babara and Hiba, and that's a little bit an easier way to prove. We work in their spirit. So you prove some H1 estimate for the V bar, for this vertical mean value, and then you prove an L4 estimate for V tilde, do it together, and then you get global existence also for this. So for the
so
with noise.
And also, you don't have a nice derivative in times. And I'm wondering how you can get uniqueness without a derivative in time. Is this tricky or?
You apply Ito formula. So it's really nearly the same way as you have to think of it always as the time integrated version of the formulas you have for the deterministic calculus. So you don't have a derivative in time. You cannot multiply the equation by something, but you can apply Ito formula, which replaces this a little bit and which helps to work around the problem.
Very good. Thank you very much. Any other question to Martin?
So in the end, you can really think of the replacement of multiplying the equation by something is the Ito formula in the stochastic calculus. That can get difficult because you have to check some assumptions to apply Ito formula, but mostly it works then in the same way when you can apply it.
So there is a special trick in stochastics. Okay, any other question to Martin? If not, thanks to Martin for his very nice talk.